This is the problems lecture of the week that starts on the 26th of April, and this lecture is related with the formulation and analysis of linear programming problems. We are going to cover three problems from 1 to 3. The first one is a typical production problem with four products and three resources. The second one is a production problem with three products and three independent production centers. And the last one is a mixing problem. So let's start with problem 3.1. In this problem, we want to produce four products identified by model 1, model 2, model 3, and model 4. These products are produced involving three phases. Cutting, shaping, and finishing. Each model should go through the three phases. We have information related with the availability of the resources, that is, the time available in each of these sections per year. That is, we have 2,000 hours in the section of cutting available. In shaping, we have 8,000 available, and in finishing, we have 5,000 available. We also have information about the time required to produce each unit of each model. For example, in the first model, we need a total of 4 hours. One hour and a half in cutting, 1 hour in shaping, and 1 hour in finishing. So in terms of the profitability, we have the contribution, the unit contribution margin. That is, for example, product one provides us 5.3 euros per unit, and so on. The highest contribution margin corresponds to product 3, which provides 8.4 euros per unit. So we want to formulate the problem, the linear programming problem, that allow us to determine the optimal production plan. We are going to provide the solution, and we want to analyze the solution also. So the formulation of the problem starts by identifying the objective. So we have a typical production problem. In a production problem, we want to produce some products with some resources that are available. And of course, we want to use the resources as efficiently as possible. We can translate this saying that we want to maximize the profit of this activity, of the production of the products with the resources available. So we are not going to use directly the profit, but we are going to use a variable which, if we maximize it, we ensure that we are maximizing the profit. That is, we are going to define a benefit that is simply the difference between the value of sales related with the products and the cost of those sales. It is convenient also to split the costs into classes. So the costs are going to be divided in variable costs and fixed costs, okay? Variable costs are costs that depend on the quantity produced. Let's consider, for example, the costs related with the raw material. So the raw material that each unit uses is the same. So the cost of that is the same for each unit. And we are going to represent it by CV. Unit variable cost. If we produce n units, x units, we have the total variable costs. Of course, that this CV, the total variable costs, are a function of x. If we increase the x, the CV increases. If we decrease x, CV decreases. Okay. The same, we can establish a similar relation with the sales. So sales are equal to the price multiplied by the quantity that we are going to produce and sell. So if you produce more, we sell more. If you produce less, we sell less. Okay? So in this way, we can replace this expression by this one, here, in which we identify this difference, the price of each unit and the variable cost of each unit. This is called the unit contribution margin, which we simply say contribution margin. That is, the contribution margin is the difference between the price and the unit variable cost. Okay? Now, with this definition, we can rewrite the benefit in this way. So and this makes clear that the benefit is a function of the quantity that we are going to produce. But it has also here a constant. The fixed costs are, for example, the costs related with the depreciation of the machines. So they are constant independently. They don't depend on the quantity that we are going to produce. Another example is the rent of the building. For example, if we have to pay rent, we pay the rent independently of we sell more or sell less. Okay. So, but mathematically, is the same. Consider the benefit, or consider only this part, the variable part, in terms of finding the location of the optimal. So maximizing the benefit is the same as maximizing the total contribution margin, which can be obtained by the product of the unit contribution margin and the quantity that will be produced. So let's look now to the decision variables. We already saw that the total contribution margin, which we want to maximize, is a function of the unit contribution margin multiplied by the quantities produced. So since in this problem we have four products, M1, M2, M3 and M4, the total contribution margin will include a contribution of each product. So we need a decision variable related to each product. And of course, as before, these decision variables are the quantities that should be produced of each product. So for M1, we will have X1. For M2, we will have X2, and so on. For M4, we will have X4. Then, once the decision variables are defined, we can start to build the problem, because the problem has two essentially elements: the objective function and the restrictions, and both are function of or are built using the decision variables. Let's look, for example, for the objective function. We have here in this table the information that we get from the initial table. So we have here the unit contribution margin of each product, and we need the total contribution margin of each product. So the objective function is simply the sum of the total contribution margins. So we have the unit contribution margins, and we know the quantities X1, X2, X3 and X4. So the contribution margin related to each product is simply this product, the unit contribution margin by the quantities, which we present here. And now let's look to the restrictions. So they can be built if we establish first their meaning. In this problem, they are related with the scarcity of the resources, and they simply state that what we are going to use cannot exceed what is available, which we can translate in this way: resource used are less or equal than the resource available. So what we have here is information that we extract from the table in which we present the data. And for example, for the section of cutting, we have here the times necessary to process one unit of M1, one unit of M2, one unit of M3, and one unit of M4. And this is the time available. So the time used to process each unit of M1 is 1.5. All units of M1 will be 1.5 multiplied by X1. The same for M2. So here I have to multiply by X2 and here by X3 to have the total time used by M1, by M2, M3 and by M4. Okay? And this will give me, so adding these products will give me the time used, and this is the time available. So the time used, as we represent here, cannot exceed the time available, 2000 hours. And the process is similar for the other three restrictions. For example, in the case of the shaping, we have X1, 5 X2, X3, and 3.5 x4. So this is the time used in shaping, and this is time available in shaping. And finally, for finishing is a similar process. We just need to use these coefficients that were given in the initial table. Now, putting it all together, we have the problem formulated. So what we have to do is to present the objective function and say what we want to do with it, maximizing or minimizing. We have also to identify that this action must be performed subject to the restrictions. We have here the restrictions that we analyzed, but we need to specify also the type of variables. And these variables must be greater or equal than zero, but they are continuous variables because we are considering that the production process is a continuous one. The problem as we presented cannot be used directly to obtain the solution because we have four decision variables and we cannot use the graphical method. But we can modify the problem so that it can be solved using a numeric technique. But the technique that we are going to use, which will be presented in the next lecture, needs that the restrictions are transformed in equalities. And to do that, in this problem, we simply restate the meaning of the restrictions. So we use the restriction in this way, that is, we cannot use more than what is available. That is, the resource that we are going to use must be less or equal than the resource that are available. So we can restate it in this way. The resource that we are going to use and those that we will not use are equal to the resources that are available. So these are resources that are in excess comparatively to what is available. So this is the case in which we need to use less than what is available. So these resources unused are the slack variables. And these slack variables appear in the problem in each restriction of the type less or equal. So this is what we have done here. So in the first restriction, we have the first slack variable, S1, the second one, S2, and in the third one, S3. Of course, that these slack variables, they represent quantities. So they must also be greater or equal than zero. So the objective of transforming the restrictions is to obtain a system of equations as we show here. So this system of equation has more variables than equations, but it can be solved. It can be solved if we consider sum of the variables equal to zero. And when we do that, the solution that we are going to obtain is called a basic solution. Okay? So the numerical solution, what it finds is that it identifies those variables that must be set equal to zero. So, if we know in advance which variables we must set to zero, we can extract the solution immediately. So, this is what I'm doing here. So, I'm not presenting now how we are going to solve this. I'm going to present only the variables that must be set to zero. Is this set here? In this problem, to obtain the optimal solution using this system of equations, we just need to set these variables equal to zero, which we call non-basic variables. Okay, so if we set these variables equal to zero in this system of equations, we can solve for the remaining variables, that is x1, x2, and x4. So, and with this information, we can evaluate the value of z. Okay, so this is the optimal solution for this problem. What is interesting to see now is that x3 is zero, so x3 is not greater than this. That is, the apparently best product, the one that has highest contribution margin, is the one that is not produced. Okay? Why? Because it uses too much time of the resources 1 and 3, which are the ones that have less time available. So the others are able to compensate the lower unit contribution margin with the higher volume. This is one of the reasons why this analysis is very important. So the unit contribution margin is of course an important parameter, but the consumption of the resources is also must also be taken in account. To confirm that in fact X3 must be zero in the optimal solution, we can force the value of X3 to be greater than zero. For example, we can introduce an additional restriction, in this case X3 greater or equal than 10, which can arise, for example, if we have a contract with a client to supply at least this number of units. So in this case, instead of three equations, we will have four equations, because this one can be transformed in this equation here. In this case, since we have a greater or equal restriction, instead of having a slack variable, we subtract an excess variable. We will see this in more detail in the next lectures. So, but the point is that now we have four equations. We can have four variables different from zero. Okay, so we can have four basic variables. Okay. So this means that we now have eight variables. This means that to obtain these four basic variables, we must set four variables equal to zero. And the optimal solution for this problem involves setting to zero these variables, the variables that we introduce here to transform the restrictions. So in this case, we must set these ones equal to zero. And if we do that, the system of equations will give us this solution. And comparing with the previous solution, we see that in fact the value of x1 decreases, because previously we have 294. This one also decreases, because previously we have 1,500. Well, here we have a slight increase, because previously we have 58.8. But the z decreases, because previously we had 12,755 euros. So this solution is worse than the previous one. So that means that in fact, increasing the amount of X3 leads to a worse solution. So it should not be in the optimal production plan, unless that we need to consider additional restrictions. And to conclude this problem, we are going also to present what is called break-even analysis. This kind of calculations we do to identify the point in which the number of sales cover the fixed costs. So we use the equation for the benefit, and we consider the benefit equal to zero. And we want to evaluate the production plan and which satisfies this equation. So to solve this, we define the total amount of units produced by adding the units produced for each product. And then we identify the fraction of units of each product in the collection of products. So in this way, we can rewrite this expression to obtain the value of x that satisfies this equation. That is, we must divide the fixed costs by the what we call the average of the contribution margin. Well, the calculations involved are presented here. For example, taking as a reference the first optimal production plan that we presented, so that production plan corresponds to the plan that should be implemented if there is enough demand to buy the products that we are able to produce. So in that circumstances, we have here the optimal production plan, and we have here the contribution margins. So having all the units corresponding to four products, we get this amount. So this is the amount of units that would be produced if we implement the optimum production plan. So the fraction that each product represents is calculated dividing the units produced by the total amount. So we get, for example, for the first product 16%, for the second one 81%, and 3% for the last one. Now, multiplying this fraction by the contribution margins allow us to evaluate the average of the contribution margins. And now, since if we set the fixed costs equal to 5,000 euros per year, we can evaluate the equilibrium point, that is, the point in which the sales are equal to the fixed costs. Okay, so we can evaluate the x corresponds to these points. So just dividing this amount, the fixed cost by this amount, and we get this value here. Okay, we get this value here. Now, with this value and the fractions of the basket of products, we can evaluate the quantities corresponded to this break-even point. So these are the amounts that should be sell for at least achieving a total contribution margin of 5,000 euros. Well, this is very important because this is a reference for the sales force. So they need to sell at least these amounts in order for the company start to generate a profit. Okay, so this serves objectives. Of course, that the total contribution margin corresponding to these values is obtained multiplying these values by the unit contribution margin, and we get these results. So, in terms of total contribution margin, this is what must be generated to at least achieve this point. And of course, when we add them, we get, of course, the value of the fixed costs. Let's look now to the second problem. So this problem is similar to the previous one, but as it has a fundamental difference. So we have three products that must be produced. We have three sections. We have the availability of the sections. We have the contribution margin of each product, but what is different now is that instead of going through the three sections, each product can be produced in a single section. For example, product one can be produced in section one, and in that case it needs 8 hours, or it can be produced in section two, in that case it needs 4 hours, and so on. Okay, so in this kind of problems arise when the company starts with a section and then it starts to increase the production capacity by introducing new factories, and new factories sometimes with better technology, so but they maintain the previous ones. So this is the case that we are considering here. And for example, we have here, for example, that in section two we cannot produce product three by technical reasons. The same in section three, we cannot produce product two. Okay, so the information is similar. We have an additional restriction, that is, product three for market conditions should not exceed the production of 20 units. And we want to do the same. We want to formulate the problem and we want to analyze the solution. So let's look to the formulation. We start by identifying the objective that we already know. The objective is to maximize the profit of the production activity. And we already know that we are going to consider the benefit, which is the difference between sales and the costs. And we split costs in variable and fixed, so we get total contribution margin less the fixed costs. We, in this case, want to maximize the total contribution margin, which has contributions from product 1, product 2, and product 3. So this is the same as before. Now, but decision variables now are more complex, because we know that the contribution margin depends on the quantity, but we don't have to decide only about the quantity. We need to decide how much and where. So decision variables are more complex. This complexity is we can deal with this by using variables with two indexes, x, y, j, which stands for the quantity of product I in section j. Okay? When we have variables of this kind, so when the decisions are more complicated, more complex, we should write all of the decision variables, because we need also to assign a meaning to collections of variables. For example, in this case, we have here the all of the variables. So we have three products, three sections. So we have a total of nine variables, and we can list them as we show here. And we can see, for example, that the first line, well, the first index is related with the quantity of the products produced. So the first line stands for, if we add these terms, stands for the quantity produced of product 1. Okay? Produced in section 1, produced in section 2, and produced in section 3. While the first column corresponds to the quantity produced in section 1. So if we consider these variables here, we see that the second index is 1, and the second index is related with the section. So this is the production in section 1. When we add them, so production of in section 1 of product 1, product 2, and product 3. So, and we need not only to specify the meaning of variables of each variable, but we need to specify the meaning of the variables in line and in column in order to be able to write the objective function and the restrictions. Now, with the meaning of the decision variables clarified, we can start by building the objective function. We already know the meaning of the objective function. It is the total contribution margin. So we need the total contribution margin for the three products. We saw in the list that we presented before that each line in the table of the set of variables corresponds to the quantity of one product. For example, the quantity of the first product produced is the first line, which involves the terms x11, x12, and x13. This is it, okay? This is the quantity of product 1. And we have here the value of the unit contribution margin. So the contribution margin of the first product is 20. So we simply need to multiply the quantity produced by the unit contribution margin, as we show here. So the contribution margin, the total contribution margin for the first product involves the sum of these variables multiplied by 20, as we show here. Okay. Now, for the second product, is the second line multiplied by 6, which we have here. So we have here the first line for the first product, second line for the second product, and the third line for the third product, which must be multiplied by 8, which is the contribution margin of the third product. Okay. Let's look now to the restrictions, and let's start with the restrictions related with the availability of the resources. So we have here this table in which we have the time available of each section. So the time available of section 1 is 200 hours, for section 2 106, and so on. And we have also here the time required in each section to produce each product. For example, in section 1, to produce one unit of product 1, we need 8 hours, and so on. To produce P2, we need 2 hours, and P3, we need three hours. So let's consider first this restriction, the restriction related with the time available in section 1. So it involves these times and it involves this availability and it involves the quantity produced in section 1, which is given by this column of variables. So we need to multiply each of these. So it's an internal internal product of these two vectors, which we represent here. So the first vector, this line, A2 and 2, and this vector here, transposed x11, x21, and x31. So performing the internal product, we get this. This is the what is used, what will be used in section 1. This is what is available. Okay. Now, in section 2 is similar. In section 2, we consider the second line in the first table and the second column. For example, for the second restriction, we have product 1 needs 4 hours, product 2 needs 2, and the third product cannot be produced. And these are the variables that must be considered. And this is the availability. So this is what we have here. 4 that multiplies x12, then 3 that multiplies x22, and from here we have 0 that multiplies x32. Okay, so this is the second restriction related with the availability. But here we can introduce an additional restriction, a technical limitation, because this corresponds to production of product 3, that is x3 in section 2, that is x32 must be 0. We cannot produce this product in section 2. So we must somehow introduce also this information in our problem. So in this case, we need these two restrictions. Another solution would be to eliminate x32 from the entire problem. Okay? That's another possibility. And finally, we have the last section, section 3. Okay, so this is the requirements. It cannot be, product 2 cannot be produced. That is, x23 must be equal to 0. And these are the quantities that must multiply these values. So this is what we have here. We have here also the condition related with this technical limitation. And we have the market condition, the quantity of product 3 should be less than 20. Well, but the quantity of product 3 is the last line of this, here it is, okay. Okay, let's see. So, this is the quantity of product 3, which cannot exceed 20 units because there is no demand for more than 20 units. Now, putting it all together, we have the linear programming problem. So what we can highlight here is that we can in fact see why we need to consider these two additional restrictions. For example, x through x32 appears here in this restriction, but x23 doesn't appear in any of the restrictions, and it appears here. And of course, if I set x23 equal to infinite, I will get z equal to infinite, and it will not contradict any of the restrictions, unless we consider it here. So one possibility is to erase completely these variables from the problem, or we can introduce these additional conditions. So what we can do with this problem is use these restrictions, these four restrictions, to build a system of equations which allow us to obtain for basic variables, and this is what we are going to see next. So with the four equations that we can use, we can obtain only four variables that can be different from zero, that is four basic variables. And the optimal solution in this case gives us the information that we have in this table. That is, these are the variables that are different from zero, that is these two. Each line corresponds to one product, so this is for product 1, this is for product 2, this is for product 3. So first section produces only product 2 and product 3, while second section produces product 1, and the same for section 3, which produces also product 1. The total amount of product 1 is 65 units, product 2 80, and so on, 24 the third. We can evaluate the total contribution margin because we have the quantities that that are here, and we have the unit contribution margin. So we can evaluate the total contribution margin for each product and add the result. And this is it. This is the end of this problem. Let's look now to the third problem. In this problem, we want to make a mixture M of oil, in which we mix three components, A, B, and C. So we have the properties of each component in terms of a viscosity index and the sulfur content. And the mixture that we want to produce must obey to certain requirements. So we cannot have a viscosity index greater than 30, and it cannot have more than 40% of sulfur. We have the price or the cost of each component, of each unit of each component. So the first component is 2.5 euros per unit, B 3 and C 2. And we want to formulate the problem and we will also analyze the solution. To formulate the problem, we need to identify the objective. So in this case, we can say that we want to find the composition that meets the technical requirements. But of course, since the price is involved, we won't obtain that with the minimum cost. And then we should move to the identification of the decision variables. So what we know is that the cost of the mixture, of course, will depend on the quantities of the components we are going to use. On the other hand, the properties of the mixture will depend linearly on the properties of the components. We know this from thermodynamics. If there are no chemical reactions, this is what we can expect. Now, the amount of M that should be produced, of the mixture that should be produced, is not specified. So we are going to solve this problem considering a unit of mass. In this case, we can state that the decision variables are the mass fraction of the components that will be used in the mixture. So X1 for the max fraction of A, X2 for the max fraction of B, and X3 for the mass fraction of C. Now, since we already have the decision variables, we can build the objective function and the restrictions. So in the case of the objective function, what we have here is the price of each component. For example, A is 2.5, B 3, and C 2. So the total price, since we are going to use X1 of A, X2 of B, and X3 of C, that is the total price or the cost of the mixture, will be adding these factors. That is 2.5 X1, 3 X2, and 2 X3, as we show here. And of course, we will want to minimize this function. Now, in terms of the restrictions, we do more or less the same thing. So we know that we are going to use X1 of A, X2 of B, and X3 of C. So, for example, the viscosity index will involve 20 multiplied by X1, 40 multiplied by X2, and 40 multiplied by X3. So this will give us the viscosity index of the mixture, because the mixture is composed by this fraction, X1, X2, and X3. So this is the viscosity of the mixture, and it cannot exceed 30. Well, similar, we do the same for the sulfur content. 45X1, 30X2, and 52X3. So this is the sulfur content of the mixture, and it cannot exceed 40. Okay. Now, we have only these two restrictions, but in fact, we need to consider another restriction because we need to consider that there is conservation of mass. That is, the mass of the mixture that we are going to get is the sum of the mass of the components that is used to obtain it. So we need to consider also these restrictions. And of course, we will have to say something about the kind of variables that we must consider. So putting it all together, we get the linear programming problem. So we have the objective function, which we want to minimize, subject to the technical restrictions, and to specify that the variables are mass fraction, they must obey to this equation, and to specify that they are fractions, they must also verify these conditions. So we have here three equations that we can use, so we can get three basic variables. And here we present the solution of this problem. As we said, we have three equations that we can use, and then we can obtain, of course, three variables that can be greater than zero, that is, three basic variables. So, since the basic variables are x1, x2, and x3, as we present here, this means that in the first restriction, the slack variable that is needed to transform the inequality in equality must be zero, and the same in the second restriction. That is, as we saw before, these inequalities to be transformed inequalities, we need to introduce the slack variables. If the slack variables are zero, this means that the viscosity index is equal to 30, and also the sulfur content must be equal to 40. And this is what we can verify here in the solution, because if we multiply if we evaluate the properties of the mixture, multiplying the mass fractions by these values, for example, we get for the viscosity exactly 30, and for the sulfur content exactly 40. And this is the cost of the mixture, 2 euros and 64 cents. And this conclude this problem and this lecture. Thank you for your attention, and see you in the next one.